Tonight we're on a special mission to find someone who very kindly and on more than one occasion has saved Earth and the galaxy from unspeakable evil.
It's the only way to travel, you know, especially when you're chasing someone through space and time. He wasn't always a high flyer. For a while, he studied to become a monk. Then he realized his true vocation was acting. He was a success on stage and screen, but the good time didn't roll for long, and to make a living, he took a job as a laborer on a building site. But his bad luck was exterminated for good when he landed the role that made his name. So, who is he? These days, he's also a successful writer. And right now, he's here at Kingston-upon-Thames signing copies of his latest book. Let's see if I can interest him in our plot.
Charts indicate objective located in this precise position.
From my past.
Yes, there's a lot of past to talk about, actually. I'm a book lover, pardon the intrusion, but I've got a book of my own, which has got your name on it, because it is entitled Tom Baker, This Is Your Life.
Good Lord.
Well, already beamed here, family members and more than a baker's dozen of friends, including actress Elizabeth Quinn, her husband, Richard O'Callaghan, and Doctor Who producer John Nathan Turner. Now, it was while you were making your name as Doctor Who that you met your wife for the past 13 of our Earth years, Sue Gerard.
You're a good girl, yes.
Now, Sue, you were an assistant film editor on Doctor Who.
I was, Michael. It was my first job in television, and I used to see Tom from afar striding through the studios. Never thought I'd meet him. And then one day, I happened to walk past him in the BBC bar, and he said to me, "Dinner?" And I said, "Yes, please." And we've had a few good dinners since then.
We'll have a few more.
That is young. So the charm works and you marry in April 1986. Your new role as a writer, Tom, is the latest chapter in a diverse life. You've lived in a monastery, worked as a nurse, been a building site labourer, married three times and drunk many dear friends under the table. And you've also found fame on stage, film and television. Let's wind back the clock.
For what we are about to receive, may the Lord make us truly grateful.
You are abominably rude, but you inspire confidence as a doctor.
If I attended all those in whom I inspire confidence, I should be worn out in a week. Lestrade, will you give us the pleasure of dining with us?
Thank you, Mr. Holmes, but it's back to the yard for me.
Then you and I, Watson, will change our clothes, stop at Marcini's for a little dinner, and then to the opera. Now, tell them what I've got here.
He is holding a primed explosive device.
And one false move and it goes right down inside his chair. Truth is, I don't know the way to the Cape of Good Hope anyway.
Well, what are we going to do?
Oh, what I usually do. Sail round and round the Isle of Wight till everyone gets dizzy.
I merely created all this so that you would feel at home. But we could just as easily be sitting here. Or here. But I thought here would be the most comfortable. And you see me like this. But this is not what I really look like.
And what do you really look like?
You don't want to know, Marty. Believe me, you don't want to know.
It's
Now, your latest role in the remake of Randall and Hopkirk Deceased has teamed you with a comic taking his first straight acting job. A short speech now from your dear friend Jim Moyer, alias Vic Reeves.
Well, I'm here growing antlers in a luxurious country resort. Now, Tom, I remember we had a fantastic time filming Randall and Hopkirk, and I remember at about 5 or 6 o'clock every evening you'd say, Jim, I feel it's time for a gin and tonic. And on the final day, you presented me with your special gin and tonic, which was a bucket of gin, a bit of tonic, some lime and ice. Delicious. I haven't looked back since. Tom, have a fantastic evening, and I hope to join you once again very soon for more gin. Cheers.
Now, the idea to bring Randall and Hopkirk back to life came from another of your funny friends, the Fast Show's Charlie Higson.
Hello, Charlie. It's good of you to come, Charlie.
Charlie, tell us all about reincarnation, please.
Well, Vic Reeves there plays the dead detective Marty Hopkirk, and I felt when we were writing it that he needed someone who could teach him how to be a ghost, a sort of spirit guide. So we needed this supernatural mentor figure, a sort of Obi-Wan Kenobi. And he had to be larger than life, a voice like God, and half mad.
Yes,
So there was only ever one name on the list.
Charlie, thank you.
Thanks, Charlie. Thank you.
So to Act One, Scene One, Tom Baker, this is your life. You're born on January the 20th, 1934, at Oxford Street Maternity Hospital in Liverpool,
yes.
The first of three children for Mary Jane and Stuart. There was you, your sister Louisa, and baby John. Your father served with the Merchant Navy on board the Mauritania and Queen Elizabeth, rising from boy waiter to chief steward. And for a while, your family lives at your aunt's house, and your cousins, Michael and Billy, are more like brothers to you. Billy, you went to school together.
Yes, we went to St. Swithin's, which was an old farmhouse converted into three classrooms.
No, but it was good, though, wasn't it? Yes.
Yeah, we used to enjoy it.
We were confident about everything then, yes. And then there was God. you know, we gave him every chance. We were so devoted to him, yeah. Because he and I were an item, as you know, for years.
Well, we'll come to that, right? We'll still...
What, you haven't got God here, have you?
Well, I mean, Well, your father was away for 2 years during the war and survived no less than three torpedo attacks. Must have thought the Germans were getting personal.
Yes.
Bombing raids on Liverpool bring fresh adventures for you and your pals, and 60 years on, here is one of them, Frank Weston. So, Frank, you went on treasure hunts together.
Yes, we did. After the air raids of the night before, we go down the shores, around the fields, we go everywhere, picking up pieces of shrapnel.
And threw stones at German prisoners of war, yes. It was incredible. But not at Italians. We were, we used to let the Italians stroke us because the Pope was Italian, yes.
Which reminds me, you were both altar boys, weren't you?
Yes, we were. We served together, didn't we?
And, yes, we did.
We had to learn Latin. And my mother, fortunately, was familiar with the Mass, and she used to teach us Latin. Didn't
she did, she did.
You came down and you were a great scholar, weren't you?
Yeah, well, a lot of talking in Latin, yes.
And you've done so well, Tom. We're so proud of you from Liverpool, yes. We really are. We
Frank,
wish you luck
you.
And continued success.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
As a boy, you're keen on sport, particularly football and running,
yes.
And you encourage a school friend to get involved. Later, you go your separate ways, but when you become well-known, he writes to you, Nick Ryan.
Hello, Tom. I didn't realise at first that you were Doctor Who, and when I found out, I went back home and said to my children, see that guy on television? I used to play with him, used to play football with him, used to go running with him. And they said, nah, don't be daft. You're kidding us. So remember, I wrote to you. You sent a card back to my daughter, Claire, saying, on the back, everything your dad said is true. Tonight, I'm off to St. Lucia with my wife to celebrate our Ruby wedding anniversary. Have a lovely evening. God bless you. Cheers, Tom.
In 1946, at the age of 12, you go to St. Matthew's Catholic School in Walton. Yeah. One day, a Christian brother comes to the school to talk about his life and work, and you were inspired, weren't you?
I was. I was then. He isn't here, is he?
No, you can relax. We'll just tell the story.
It's okay. Yeah, yeah.
So you decide to join. After initial instruction in Shropshire comes the big question, is the monastic life really for you? Now, you've written that when you were sent to the Maison Bon Secours, a monastery in Jersey, your happiness was complete, but obviously it didn't last.
Well, that's the way it is with happiness, isn't it?
Yes.
You don't expect it to last. I was looking for another kind of happiness. I think one goes through lots of happinesses. This is my latest happiness. But I hope this one lasts. So it was another happiness, you know, which was inevitably going to fail.
Well, leaving the order might have disappointed the brothers, but you were more concerned about upsetting your mother, so you call on your cousin Billy for his support.
I did.
Billy, you remember that?
Yeah, the day that you came to our house, you remember?
Yes.
And you were
yes.
dressed in your black suit.
Yeah.
A hat. And you were crying, actually.
I was. Mm. I was so distraught and afraid of hurting my mother. So in my grief, I went to my Auntie Louie and to Billy. That's right, first. It was an amazing day. I'll never forget that,
remember?
Bill.
Yeah.
Yeah, never.
But your mother wanted you to be happy, right? Of course.
Yes, of course she wanted me to be happy, yeah. I mean, yes, she adored me. And I always wanted to be adored. Actually, I wanted to be worshipped, but...
Well, from the quiet contemplation of the monastery, you get a massive culture shock in 1955. Age 21, you're conscripted into the army. You're posted to a British military hospital in Germany as a medical orderly.
Yes.
And I've flown in from Australia to say thank you, Tom, for saving my life.
40 years on, from Adelaide, your army pal, Tony Maudsley.
Tony Maudsley, yes.
Tony, this sounds suitably dramatic.
I was the butt of a barrack room joke going really wrong. I'd hopped into bed, I was just about to go off to sleep, and about six guys out the billet got the end of my bed and tipped it up. Do you remember that? They tipped the bed up.
Yeah.
I slid through the top rung of the bed, and my head was against the wall, and they were pushing to try and get their bed upright.
Yeah, that's right. And I asked them to stop.
You didn't ask them to stop. You didn't ask them. I heard this thunderous roar coming down the barrack room there, and I heard you shouting, put him down, put him down.
Yeah.
And then they dropped the bed down, and that's when I saw you standing there, two fists up, all ready to go. Come on, you guys, one at a time, but all together.
I didn't say one at a time.
I said all together.
Oh, I said all together. Yeah, that sounds more preposterous. But one at a time makes me shiver a bit. Yeah.
But I'm here because of that, mate.
Oh, good.
Not sure.
Thank you, Tony, very much. Now, while you're in the army, you perform in a Christmas review and you're bitten by the bug. You're convinced the actor's life is for you.
Yeah.
And after the army, you enroll at the Rose Bruford College of Speech and Drama at Sidcup in Kent.
Yes.
Whenever I think of you, Tom, I think of sausages.
Well, that's a start. He was a student with you, Malcolm Tierney.
Oh. Yes.
Malcolm, sausages, I think you said.
Sausages, yes. I was in a play at the Royal Court, long hair, beard and everything, and I'd adopted a philosophy of frugalism and shunning worldly pleasures and so on. I was living out in Greenwich, and you hadn't got anywhere to live, and you were completely broke. And you were an absolutely model lodger. You know, you tidied it up for me, kept the place clean, and you never complained once about the sausages. Anyway, one night I come back, I do the potatoes, and I'm going for the sausages, and you say, Mel, bad news, I'm afraid. The sausages are no longer with us. And I said, but, oh, you mean you've eaten them? They said, no, they're off. They're off, they're buried, they're dead and buried. They probably died about a week ago, but I hadn't got the nerve to tell you. you see. And so I was so mortified by this, I gave up frugalism forever. And, and that's my story.
I'm so glad.
Yes. So I joined you.
Thank you, Martin.
Thank you. Yeah.
As a newly qualified thespian, you're not a very busy one, although you do manage to find yourself a wife, Anna Wheatcroft.
Yes.
And you have two sons, yes. Daniel and Piers. But the marriage ends in 1967, and you lose touch with the boys. Yes. 3 years ago, you flew with Sue to New Zealand to appear in a commercial. And we go to Auckland now to take up the story with your son, Piers.
Hello, Tom. It was here in January 97, I'm sure you remember, where we had one of the most bizarre meetings of our life. I walked into the restaurant, looking for a table, and who do I see but you there? Quite a shock for me, but nothing compared to the shock for you. I had to plan my strategy of how to introduce myself to you. I hadn't seen you for so many years. I had a word with the waiter, asked him if I could take care of your tab, of which I did, and therefore you'd have to come to the bar and inquire about who had paid this tab, of which of course you did. Now, there was a semblance of recognition you had in your eye, but I thought I should help you along the way, so I introduced myself to you. My name's Baker, I said. Piers Baker. Well, the look on your face, really quite fantastic. A great reunion we had, too. I'm delighted you're being honoured this evening, and delighted that we're back in touch.
Well, he certainly has the Baker voice. That must have been quite unnerving for you.
He was, yes. I looked at him and I said, I think I should tell him, is your name Morgan or something? He said, no, my name's Baker, Piers Baker. I'm your son. That was the killer, yeah. Naturally, I said, how do you do? And introduced him to his stepmother.
Well, back to the plot and the 1960s. Your life isn't exactly swinging. And then you write and you perform your own comedy fringe show and impress a talent spotter from the National Theatre.
Yes.
You audition for Laurence Olivier and you join the company, playing a variety of roles, including a very convincing horse in The Travails of Sancho Panza. But then Olivier suggests you for a part in a new film about the doomed Russian Tsar Nicholas and his family. One night, the Hollywood producer, Sam Spiegel, comes to see you on stage, and that's how you become Rasputin, the Mad Monk.
Oh, yes.
I don't like St. Petersburg. It makes me drink too much. And when I drink, the women come. The women here are worse than the peasants in my village. They have no restraint. Is Matushka angry with me?
She won't admit you even take a drink, much less... No. She believes in you completely.
She is a saint.
Playing Tsar Nicholas in that film, Michael Jaston.
Yes.
So Michael's film was Nicholas and Alexandra, and... Rasputin was a terrific character.
Well, it was absolutely perfect casting because Tom had been a monk and he was mad, so he plays a mad monk. And he did get the Golden Globe nomination for Best Newcomer. We've marched together for 30 years and you're not mad, you're a glorious eccentric. And your boundless generosity to me and my family, I can't repay it, and I cherish your friendship.
Oh, good.
Good luck.
Thank you, man. Next, you appear in Italian director Pier Paolo Pasolini's film of the Canterbury Tales, and then disappointingly work dries up. For a while you teach English to foreign students, but by 1973 you're hard up and fed up. After that you take on a different kind of toil, labouring on a building site.
Yes.
And there was no time for play acting with us, Tom.
With his brother John, your boss Arthur Cordes.
Yeah.
You hired Tom as a builder's mate.
Well, yes, yeah, a general labourer. he wasn't a bad lad either.
Thanks.
Did he specialise in anything? What was he
liked the Kango. He was a great Kango man.
Yes.
What's a Kango?
He liked the a Kango. It's deep.
It's it. He means a drill. It was a vengeance.
Always
yes. But I liked it, yes.
Have you still got the white suit, Tom?
I've still got the Kango.
Gentlemen, thank you very
much. Thanks so much.
Well, it was while you were hammering or drilling away on the building site in 1974 that you remember a name from your past. A few years earlier, you'd appeared in the BBC play The Millionairess with Maggie Smith. The director was Bill Slater, and Bill, Tom wrote to you.
Yes, he did. His timing was always superb. It just so happened that letter arrived as I was about to become head of drama serials. And in this pathetic letter, Tom had written, "Dear Bill, I haven't worked in 2 years. Is it something I said?" And I suddenly had this wonderful picture of Tom, his wild eyes, like a Merlin, storming his way through the universes, in a TARDIS, of course. I got wildly excited, but I wasn't the producer. Barry Letzier was the producer. Right. So as soon as I could, I got hold of Barry. "You've got to meet Tom Baker!"
What happened next, Barry?
Well, you see, as producer, I'd been searching for months to find a doctor unsuccessfully. But within minutes, it was obvious he would make a fantastic Doctor Who, and our search was over.
And I'm very grateful. Those two men there, and with your colleague Sean Sutton, I remember being kind to me, but those two men there changed my entire life. I'm a big star in Abu Dhabi, and I don't know how to turn that to my advantage, but everywhere, because of those two, yeah. Yeah, that's right.
So you win the role, and as part of the publicity, you're even pictured with your mates on the building site.
Yeah, look.
In December 1974, you make your first appearance as the fourth Doctor Who. Doctor, doctor, give me the news, I've got a bad case of loving you. No pills gonna kill my ear, I got a bad case of loving you.
Ken, are you all right?
Affirmative.
Good, good.
Come on, Sarah. We've an appointment in London. We're already 30,000 years late.
Here now, your very first assistant, Elizabeth Sladen, and the voice of K-9, John Leeson. Elizabeth, take us back.
I love lots of things about Tom, but what I love most is he always managed to make anyone who worked on the programme feel so special, so wanted, so important.
Endorsed.
That's how you remember it, John.
Very much so. I mean, Tom was absolutely special. I've never worked with such an energised actor in my life, and I don't expect I shall work with such an energised actor again. Yeah. And the three Doctor Who fans whom I've spoken to in the last 17 years said they quite enjoyed you too.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Oh,
thank you.
See you in a minute. Thank you.
You're the definitive Doctor for 6 years until 1981. During that time, you marry your co-star, Lalla Ward, but later you part.
Yes.
As Doctor Who, you record more than 170 episodes, but eventually you cast your scarf to the winds. It's goodbye, Doctor Who, but Tom Baker works on in television and on stage. In 1984, you're in the National Theatre tour of She Stoops to Conquer.
Oh, Tom, yeah. You always gave me pause for thought.
Your co-star, Julia Watson.
Oh, yes, yes. Hi,
Julia. Hello. Julia was my daughter in the piece.
I was, yes. And a very happy daughter. You were playing a very frustrated Mr. Hardcastle, and you invented the series of war dances that would grow as the evening went on and you became more and more frustrated.
Yes.
And we did several months at the National, and then you decided to leave, and I re-rehearsed with another actor playing my father, Michael Bryant. And the director during these re-rehearsals said, "Why are you leaving pauses at these points in the scene?" And I thought, "I don't know." And then I remembered. It was because I left pauses for these wonderful war dances that used to entertain me and the audience as you pirouetted round the stage.
Oh, did I?
And I don't know if the Royal Ballet ever realise what they were missing?
Not anymore. Thank you very much, Julia. In a Royal Shakespeare production of Willie Russell's Educating Rita, you played the hard-drinking professor. Yeah. And Rita was Kate Fitzgerald.
Sure.
Kate, a tailor-made part for Tom.
Well, yes, it was, and we had a good few drinks on the way, didn't we, Tom? But my overriding memory is of a very big man with an even bigger heart. And there was one particular time in Ayr, and we were at the end of a long, arduous tour, and it was the last day of the week. We'd done 8 performances, and my father had taken the opportunity of going to Glasgow to pick up a lady who'd been very kind to him when he'd be billeted there during the war and bringing her to Ayr to see the show. But they couldn't get back. There were problems with the trains or something. And Tom immediately gave up his hotel room so she could have somewhere comfortable to spend the night.
The next year, you're back on the box playing a priest in Faye Weldon's The Life and Loves of a She-Devil,
yeah,
adapted for the screen by your friend Ted Whitehead. Another TV hit is Medics with Dinah Stab, Hugh Quashie, yes, and someone who is now a member of the lovable royal family, Sue Johnston.
Hi, Tom. Congratulations. Well, I think this is a really lovely thing for you, and it's a lovely thing for me, because I can get a word in without you interrupting me. Tom, I miss working with you. We had such fun on Medics. You made me laugh so much. You're a fountain of joy and knowledge, and I miss you very much, and we've still got that date, remember, to go and watch Liverpool at Anfield. Don't forget. Have a great time, and I hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.
And here's another voice from Memory Lane. Well, Coronation Street, actually.
What did you say your name was, Inspector? Ghoul?
He was Derek Wilton. He is Peter Baldwin.
Peter Baldwin, yeah. Peter Baldwin, yeah.
Peter, that was a line from an Inspector Calls.
An Inspector Calls, yes. We played at the Westminster Theatre. You remember,
yes,
13 years ago?
Yeah.
Tom was a majestic inspector, and I was a less than majestic Arthur Burling, the head of the family. But I think we worked together well on stage, Tom, didn't we?
I think so. We got lots of laughs, I think.
Yes, I don't think we were intended to, but I giggled a lot, which you,
yeah,
I don't think you appreciated. But there is one other reason I have to remember that production. Towards the end of the run, my wife went into hospital with cancer, you remember, and she died a few weeks later. And it was very difficult going on stage every night. But your kindness, your understanding, your thoughtfulness was immeasurable. I remember coming back from the hospital one day to the theatre, and there was a lot of champagne in the fridge. And I said, Tom, this is not a time for celebration. And you said, champagne is not only for celebration, it is for friendship. And I've never forgotten that. Thank you very much.
You. The last few years have unleashed another of your talents, writing. Today I surprised you while you were publicising your book, The Boy Who Kicked Pigs. It's a follow-up to the success of your 1997 autobiography, Who on Earth is Tom Baker, which you dedicated to Sue. In the introduction, you recount the reunion with your long-lost son. Earlier, we heard how his work as a horticulturalist keeps him busy in New Zealand.
However, not today.
From Auckland, your son, Piers.
Ah! Has to be done.
Yeah.
That was a clever trick, that. I kept thinking you must be still in New Zealand. Yes, it's good, yes.
Yes.
Tom Baker, this is your life.
Ah, thank you. Thank
you. And Tom Baker's back in Randall and Hopkirk Deceased next Saturday at 8:55 here on BBC One.